marijuana is as bad for you or worse than tobacco? Impossible. If they had the evidence, they'd be putting emaciated bodies or emphysema, lung cancer, black lungs, they would be parading them throughout the media. They don't have one. Yet people somehow think that it might cause the same thing.
$250,000?
$300,000?
For marijuana, I'd probably say then
$80,000. I would say it would be hundreds of billions.
Get ready for it. Here it comes.
There are no deaths from cannabis use anywhere. You can't find one.
In 10,000 years of known use of marijuana, there's never been a single death attributed to marijuana. There's 400,000 deaths in America alone every year that are directly attributed to tobacco.
There are more kids in addiction clinics for marijuana than any other substance. This must mean that marijuana is the most addictive substance today.
It's undoubtedly true that there are more teenagers and kids in treatment for marijuana than all the other drugs combined. What the DEA never tells you is why that's true.
A kid is caught possessing or smoking marijuana. He's taken to court. He's given a choice. Either you know, some horrible penalty, or you go to a treatment center. Obviously chooses to go to treatment and goes to treatment there. He's considered an addict.
But then the DEA gets the point of that stat and say, look at all these kids in treatment for marijuana. God, it must be because today's marijuana is not the marijuana that your parents were smoking.
As far as I understand, only 3% of the people in treatment for marijuana are there voluntarily. The other 97% were told to by their guardian or told to by a judge. You can choose between jail or treatment. And a lot of people choose treatment.
It provides no basis for speaking about addiction. Anybody who is at all sophisticated about marijuana would rate them the way two researchers were asked to rate drugs in order of addiction. Nicotine was one, alcohol was two, then heroin, then cocaine, then coffee, and then marijuana. There may have been a couple of other drugs, but marijuana was at the very bottom, below coffee.
This narcotic, unlike the opiates, the synthetics, and cocaine, is non-addictive.
What do you mean by non-addictive?
By non-addictive, it is meant that the user of marijuana, when deprived of the drug, will not experience the agonies of withdrawal. It is habituating, but its use can be discontinued.
Then what is its danger?
In the days of Harry Anslinger, it was called the stepping stone hypothesis. If you stepped on this stone, marijuana, you are bound and determined to go on to the next stone, which would be one of the so-called hard drugs.
Every time it's been studied and looked at and so on, they have never ever found that there's certainly nothing in marijuana that makes you want to go to anything else.
There is no inherent psychopharmacological property of the drug which pushes one toward another drug.
I'll smoke a joint. I want a bag of chips and fucking junk food. I don't want to go out and get ripped.
I drink alcohol. That's my drug of choice. It could be said I started on milk. I mean, this is crazy. If I use marijuana, why does that automatically make me a candidate to black tar heroin? It's a nonsensical argument.
In fact, only one out of every 104 marijuana users use cocaine, and less than one use heroin.
The black market throws the dealers of soft drugs together with the dealer of hard drugs.
So if you have a black market and you have a dealer that's dealing in marijuana and LSD and everything else, and the dealer might say to you, hey, you want to try something stronger? Well, in that sense, because of the black market, because of prohibition, people may be more susceptible to seeing these other drugs and being willing to try these other drugs.
And so what you see is that there is a gateway effect. But it's a gateway effect caused by prohibition and the blending of the hard and soft drug markets.
You will be useless to society if you use marijuana. But if that's true, well, there are about 50 million people who smoke marijuana in America and over half of the Canadian population who've tried it. And yet, both societies seem to flourish. And just look who some of these people are.
Steve Jobs developed Apple Computer smoking pot. Ted Turner developed CNN News smoking pot. Still smokes a joint every day. You go through every musician you like, from the Rolling Stones to the Beatles to Led Zeppelin, they all smoke pot.
Snoop Dogg, Willie Nelson.
Come on, Bill Clinton for
he didn't inhale, man.
He smoked, he didn't.
Hell yeah.
Don't be so naive.
Virtually every presidential candidate has now copped to using marijuana at some time in his or her life.
A few times in the Army, I tried marijuana. It was not a significant part of my life.
I had a senior law enforcement official tell me that in his judgment, up to a quarter of the White House staff when they first came in had used drugs in the last 4 or 5 years.
The people that have personality problems and the people that are going to be lazy and going to lose their job, they're going to lose their job anyway. They're not losing their job because of marijuana. That's just a lie.
Cannabis, from an operational point of view, should be illegal.
I do think it should be legal because of the harm that it does to people's minds.
No, where did you read
also,
that?
There's also an argument that you could say that cigarettes should be made illegal.
Yeah, sure.
Well, but nothing should be made illegal if it's your voluntary choice. Yeah. Well,
all right. Because we need some sort of...
Because, you know, me mate Dave, he grows 16 plants in his basement, creates an incredible chronic, and every Friday night we go there, we smoke up, and we watch the series of The Wire, we watch The Sopranos, we don't hurt anyone. But why are we criminals? Why are we criminals for doing that?
Because the legislation is there that states that it's illegal.
Yeah, but surely, but if we say that we should obey the law, does that mean that the law is our boss?
You have to obey the laws of the land, don't you?
Yeah, but I obey the common law.
You can disagree with certain laws, and that's your personal choice, but to me, if those laws are there,
sure. I think that you understand the common law as a police sergeant, causing no harm, loss, or injury to someone else, that's real law. But if I want to sit at home and smoke weed, cannabis to myself until my brain explodes,
that's his right.
That's my right as an adult, isn't it?
Well, don't tell us you're doing it.
Yeah, okay, I won't tell you I'm doing it. No, no, no.
Isn't it? It's illegal to distribute, but not to have it.
No, thanks anyway. Cheers, man.
Yeah, no worries.
Cheers.
Sweet.
Well, thanks, guys, for letting me film. I hope you guys have an amazing week and weekend. And remember, man.
Look up to the cameraman,
yeah?
Yeah. Cameraman, not the police.
And stay stealthy. Stay stealthy. That's all I got to say.
Keep them greens burning.
Keep the greens. Thank you very much, guys.
People need to realize the only reason why it's illegal is because of economics. It's because there's like 1,000 different things that marijuana would fix that pharmaceutical drugs right now are prescribed for. And it would cost the pharmaceutical companies billions and billions of dollars every year. If marijuana was made illegal, it would cost alcohol companies. When you see those commercials, like those the talking dog, the pot commercial, those are sponsored by Partnership for a Drug-Free America. Mm-hmm. Partnership for a Drug-Free America is funded by alcohol companies. It's hilarious. Alcohol's a drug! In 1935, they came out with a machine called a decorticator. And what a decorticator is, it allows you to effectively and economically effectively process hemp fiber. Because before, they used to use slavery. And when slavery was abolished in 1865, they had no means effectively producing this pulp. Like, but the Declaration of Independence was printed on hemp. The parachute that George Bush Sr. used to parachute in World War II, that was made out of hemp. Hemp was had huge industrial uses. It was just very difficult to process. And so they came out with this machine called a decorticator, and it allowed them to really effectively produce it. And then Popular Science had this cover that said, hemp, the new billion-dollar product, and everyone was going to start using hemp for paper, for textiles. And William Randolph Hearst, who owned all these newspapers, yeah, and on top of that, owned all these paper mills, it was going to cost him millions of dollars, wow, to convert over to hemp. So instead, he started printing stories in his paper about some new drug called marijuana. And marijuana wasn't even a slang term for cannabis. Marijuana was used to describe a type of Mexican wild tobacco, completely unrelated. So they called it marijuana, and they said, this is how they got it illegal. They said, people are smoking it, and blacks and Mexicans are raping white women. So Congress outlawed this new drug, not even knowing they were outlawing hemp. They had no idea, which hemp had been in use for thousands and thousands of years.
Yeah.
And so then they came out with all these videos, or these movies rather, like Reefer Madness and all these propaganda films. And it was all just to get people to think that there's something wrong with this one. It was totally economic. 400,000 people every year died directly in this country alone, directly from use of cigarettes.
Yeah.
No one's ever died from pot, ever. But it's illegal. And you're not going to live forever. All right, you're gonna live and you're gonna die, and everybody is. We're all temporary beings going through this life, and you know, who are you to tell other people what they can and can't do? Alcohol doesn't make you a drunk.
Right.
You know, I drink and then I stop drinking, and then I go get something to eat and I hang out and I won't drink for weeks. It's crazy.
Yeah.
You know, it's called moderation, and you apply it to every aspect of your life. I mean, if you want to get addicted, you can get addicted to spanking it. You can get addicted to gambling. You can
Guilty.
Get addicted to anything. Scratch tickets. People say, well, you can abuse alcohol. You can abuse pot. You can abuse cheeseburgers, too.
Yeah.
You know, but I like cheeseburgers. It should be legal.
Yeah.
All this stuff should be legal. We're not children. We're adults. But we got this one plant that's illegal. You're not going to live forever. This is a short time that we're here for. All different psychedelics, not just pot, because pot is a very mild psychedelic. And if pot is a gateway, it's a gateway to other things that also are consciousness expanding, like mushrooms and LSD, or all sorts of things that are also illegal.
You used the most powerful hallucinogen known to man, DMT?
Well, everybody's used that, really, because your brain makes it.
Yeah.
Your brain makes it while you're asleep. While you're in heavy REM sleep, everyone's brain produces way more than the effective dose. So what that means is, if you take the drug, like if it's chemically synthesized from a plant, and you take it, the amount you need to take is not nearly as much as your brain produces while you're in REM sleep. What I describe it as, it's like complex geometric patterns that are made out of love. Like you go literally to another dimension. The crazy thing is that everybody does it every night while you sleep. Nobody ever thinks about why you sleep. Like what you do is, when you sleep, is you shut off. You shut off and you just accept it, because we do it every night. But 8 hours of your day is somewhere you don't understand. You don't know about. You don't know what it is. You just go blank,
right,
and then you wake up and it's over. But you're going through an intense psychedelic trip during that whole time. And the same thing as, you know, when you wake up from a dream, you can't remember it. Like, oh, this crazy dream, and it seems so real. And then 5 minutes later, you don't even know what the hell you were talking about.
Right.
You don't remember the dream. That's exactly what happens when you smoke DMT. When you take this drug, you have these insane visions, and then you could barely remember it just a few minutes later. And it's because your conscious brain is trying to protect you from this experience, because it's so mind-blowing. It's not scary, because it's exactly the same thing that happens to you when you die. But this is what happens to you when you die. I mean, this is the chemical that your brain produces. And it's produced by a part of your brain called the pineal gland. And literally, it's your third eye.
Right.
It's literally in the center
right
of your
the
brain
middle, yeah,
where the third eye is. And it actually, in reptiles, it has a retina and a cornea and a lens. And they've done all these scientific studies on it. They did a bunch of clinical trials at the University of New Mexico. They did a book on it called DMT, the Spirit Molecule. And what this is literally like a portal to the afterlife. It allows you to sneak a peek over there and come back. It's mind-blowing. The crazy thing is, they've known about this since like 1960. If you saw a movie and there was a substance in this movie that existed in every single ecosystem, it's in plants and it's everywhere. It's in grass. You take phalaris grass and you extract it, you get DMT from it, literally. I mean, it's in more plants than it's not in. And if there was a drug that allowed you, If you smoked it, you could literally see God, literally have a communication with pure wisdom. Wouldn't you think that everybody would have heard about that?
Yeah.
Could you think that you could keep something like that under wraps for like 40, 50 years? This is what should be legal. All plants should be legal because they don't make strychnine illegal. Strychnine exists in Strychnus vomosus or something like that. There's a bunch of different plants that produce strychnine, and they're legal plants. You can buy them, you can make strychnine. You know why? It's not about something that kills you. It's about something that you won't be able to absorb propaganda the way you do now. You won't be able to look at the news the way you do now. You won't be able to look at common cultural conditioning and predetermined patterns of behavior. None of that stuff will make sense.
It's very difficult to
go through life after you've gone through that experience.
Okay.
The way I describe it, it's like any intense psychedelic experience is like pressing control, alt, delete on your brain.
Yeah.
That's what it's like. It's like your brain reboot. It should freak you out.
Yeah, it does freak
me out. But it freaks you out because you like to be in control.
Yeah.
But you're not in control, bitch. You're going to die. No one's in control. You're in control of your body for a short period of time, and you should experiment with it.